Inkyard Press and Harper Audio present These Feathered Flames by Alexandra Overy, performed by Fiona Hardingham. Part 1. The Girl Who Grew Claws. Once in Tourin, two princesses were born, of mortal blood, but divinely sworn. When monsters of chaos prowled the night, to protect a queendom, the girls took flight. To the old hallowed lands, where they first swore an oath, to pay the greatest price and sever them both. So there the merciless earth took its claim, binding one to the throne and one to the flame. The Queen and the Firebird. Chapter 1. The prey wasn't meant to be a child. When Asya had smelled the sharp tang of magic, strong even before she emerged from the tree line, that possibility hadn't so much as fluttered across her mind. It was never meant to be a child. But the scent of magic was undeniable. That indistinguishable combination of damp overturned earth and the metallic copper of blood cut through with the acrid burn of power. It was overlaid with the cloying sweetness of water rose, as if someone had tried to mask it. A futile attempt. And Asya was sure this time. The person they were looking for had to be here. The comfort of the forest stood at her back, the dark canopy of trees stretching behind her in every direction. The fading sunlight could not break through the writhing tangle of branches, so in the shadow of the trunks, it was dark as twilight. Most people feared the forest, stories of monsters that lurked in its depths, witches who lured unsuspecting children in and tore out their hearts. But to Asya, it had always felt safe. The gnarled trunks and rustling leaves were like old friends. "This is it," Asya said, inclining her head toward the clearing in front of them. A slight smile tugged at her lips. 2 years ago, when her great aunt had first deemed Asya ready to try tracking, to follow the magic with only her mortal senses once they were close enough to the source, she'd found it impossible. More often than not, she just led them in circles until Taya gave up on her. But today, Asya had managed it. She might not be as unwavering as her aunt, as strong or as dutiful, but at least Asya had succeeded in this. She glanced over at Taya, waiting for her reaction. But her aunt stood stiller than the trees, an immovable presence in their midst. The shadowed light filtering through the leaves cast her face in stark relief, carving deep hollows into her snow-white cheeks and emphasizing the wrinkles at her brow. She could have been a painting, one of the old oil portraits of the gods, soft brushstrokes of light adding an ethereal glow to her stern face. It made her look otherworldly, inhuman, which she was. One of the creatures that prowled these trees. While Asya, or any other mortal, could smell the residual magic, her aunt could feel it. No amount of water rose or burned sage, or any of the other tricks people tried, could hide magic from Taya. Her dark eyes flickered to Asya. "Correct," her aunt murmured, a hint of satisfaction in her soft voice. In front of them, the comforting trees gave way to an open paddock. It had been allowed to run wild, chamomile glinting yellow in the long grass, like sunspots on water. Purple-capped mushrooms pushed their way through the weeds, intertwining with the soft lilac of scattered crocuses. The tinge of pride in Asya's chest melted away, replaced by a thrumming anticipation. The paddock could have been beautiful, she supposed, but the cold apprehension burning in her stomach overshadowed it, darkening the flowers to poisonous thorns and muting the colours like fog. It was always like this, ever since the first time Taya had taken her on a hunt. Once she was left without a task to complete, a distraction. Asya couldn't pretend to forget what came next. She'd hoped it would get better, but she still couldn't shake the lingering fear. She shifted her feet, trying to ignore the erratic rhythm of her heart. She hated waiting. Each frantic beat, stretching out into an eternity. She just wanted this to be over. After all, her sister had always been the brave one. But that was why Asya was here. Why she had to follow this path, no matter how she wavered. She owed it to her sister. They were the two sides of a coin, and if Asya failed, then her sister would too. Taya's words, the words Asya had to live by, pounded through her. This is our duty. Not a question of right or wrong, but balance. Her aunt stepped forward. She moved silently, slipping like a shadow untethered from its owner, from the gnarled trees and out into the overgrown paddock beyond. She didn't speak. She rarely did when she felt a calling. But Asya knew she was meant to follow. Asya took a shaky breath, touching one finger to the wooden icon around her neck, an unspoken prayer. She could do this. Far less quietly, she followed Taya into the uneven grass, wincing at the snapping twigs beneath her boots. The paddock led to a small cottage, surrounded by more soft crocuses. Their purple seeped out from the house like a bruise. The building's thatched roof had clearly been recently repaired, and the grey stone was all but consumed by creeping moss. The stench of magic grew with each step. Water roses lay scattered on the ground, interspersed with dried rosemary sprigs. The too sweet scent, cut through with the burn of magic, made Asya's stomach turn. Taya stopped by the wooden door. Marks of various saints had been daubed across it in stark black paint, uneven and still wet. Acts of desperation. They felt out of place in the idyllic scene. The sight sent a prickle of unease through Asya's gut. Your weapon, Taya prompted, her voice as low as a rustle of grass behind them. Asya's fingers jumped to the curved bronze shashka at her waist. A careless mistake. She should have drawn the short blade long before. She couldn't let the apprehension clawing at the edge of her mind overwhelm her. Not this time. She had to be sure. Uncompromising. She had to be like Taya. Asya unsheathed the weapon, the bronze glinting in the fading light, and forced her hand to steady. Her aunt gave her a long look, one that said she knew just how Asya's heart roiled beneath the surface. But Taya just nodded, turning back to the freshly marked door. Sparks already danced behind her eyes, deep red and burnished gold flames swallowing her dark irises. It transformed her from ethereal into something powerful. Monstrous. Asya pushed that thought away. Her aunt wasn't a monster. Taya reached out and pressed her palm to the wood. Heat rolled from her in a great wave, making Asya's eyes water. A low, splintering noise fractured the air, followed by the snap of the metal bolt. The door swung open. All that was left of the painted sigils was a scorched handprint. Asya's mouth went dry. She couldn't help but feel that breaking the saint's signs was violating some ancient covenant. But Taya just stepped inside. Asya tightened her grip on the blade, trying to shake off the sense of foreboding, nipping at her heels, and followed. The cottage comprised a single small room. Heavy fabric hung over the windows, leaving them half in shadow. As Asya's vision adjusted, she took in the shapes of furniture, all overturned or smashed against the cracked walls. Clothes were strewn across the floor in a whirl, along with a few shattered plates and even a broken vila. Its strings snapped and useless. A statue of Saint Meshnik lay on its side, their head several paces from their armored body. The room looked like it had been ransacked, perhaps set upon by thieves, or like someone wanted it to seem that way. Taya turned slowly, her sparking eyes taking in the room, then her gaze fixed on a spot to her left, and flames reared across her irises again. Asya couldn't see anything, but she knew her aunt was not really looking at the wall. She was feeling, reaching for those intangible threads that bound the world and using them to narrow in on her prey. Asya waited, her breath caught in her chest. Taya moved in a flash, as though Vetvia herself had looked down and granted her secret passage through the in-between. One moment beside Asya, the next in front of the wall. Flames, golden and bright as sunlight, sputtered from her wrists, licking along her forearms. She put her hands on the wall, and the flames eagerly reached out to devour. They burned away what must have been a false panel, revealing a tight crevice behind. Three faces stared out, eyes wide and afraid. Two children, a boy and a girl, clutching onto a man with ash-white hair, now covered in a faint sheen of soot.
Oyase,
he breathed, terror rising on his face like waves over a hapless ship. Firebird. Bile burned in Asya's throat. She took a halting step back, staring at the huddled family. It's the man, she told herself. It had to be. The thought murmured through her, a desperate prayer to any god or saint who might be listening. The man leaped forward, spreading his arms as though hiding the children from view might protect them, as though anything he did would make a difference.
I won't let you touch her,
he cried, grabbing one of the broken chair legs and brandishing it like a sword. Asya clenched her teeth, a sharp jab of pity shooting through her. It would be no use. Nothing would. The flames coiled lazily around Taya's wrists as she watched the man with a detached curiosity. The price must be paid. He let out a low sob, the chair leg clattering uselessly to the ground as he clasped his hands together, as if in prayer.
Please, take it from me. She didn't know what she was doing.
The room was too hot, the flames scorching the very air in Asya's lungs. This is what has to be done, she intoned. This is our duty. The same words her aunt had hammered into her. Asya's knuckles shone white on the hilt of her shashka, the cool metal tethering her to the ground, to this moment, and not the rising guilt in the back of her mind, a panic that threatened to crush her. I cannot. Taya said, her voice hollow. The price must be taken from the one who cast the spell. With a casual flick of her wrist, a burst of fire sprang at the man. He dived aside, toppling into an overturned table. The little boy was crying now, soft whimpers barely louder than the spitting flames. But the girl did not cry, even as Taya wrapped an elegant hand around her arm and dragged her forward. Asya saw the Stratzvier clearly against the milk-white skin of the girl's wrist, a mass of black lines that coalesced to form a burning feather, seared into her flesh like a brand. The mark of the Firebird. The mark that meant a debt had to be paid.
Please,
the man said again, pulling himself from the collapsed table.
Please, she didn't mean to.
Asya, her aunt said, without looking up from the mark. Asya knew what she was meant to do, but her legs took a moment to obey, muscles protesting, though her mind could not. But she moved forward anyway, placing herself between the man and the little girl, shashka raised in warning. No one could interfere with the price. The man scrambled for the chair leg again, leveling it at Asya with trembling hands.
She only did it to save her brother,
he pleaded. Emotion cracking through his voice like summer ice.
He was sick. She didn't know the consequences.
Asya's gaze slid to the little girl, to the determined set of her jaw, her defiantly dry eyes. That look wrenched something in Asya's chest. The resolve she'd so carefully built crumbled around her,
She knew what it was like to have a sibling you would do anything, risk anything for. But Taya was unmoved. Now she will know. Magic always comes with a price. He lunged.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.